I welcome you to the 8th session of Finishing School program. This session is taken by the head of the Department of Social Sciences, by Mr. T. Joseph Christados. Sir has been teaching English language, literature, and communication for more than 30 years. He has been with the Institute of St. Mary's since 1997. For over a decade, he has been a key member of IQAC and coordinator during two successive NAC accreditations. Currently, Sir is the head of the Department of Social Sciences and Communications, also recognized by the Government of Telangana with the State Award for Meritorious Teachers in September 2018. Also won the Indira Pirya Darshini National Award for Excellence in Education in November 2017. I request Joseph Sir to start the session on the topic Image Building. Do you have what it takes? Welcome, Sir.
Yeah, thank you, Mohit, for that introduction. It's such a pleasure to be with all of you. A section, I would know all of you because I taught, but the other section, maybe I would have seen you in the corridors and we may not know so closely, but then that's okay. This morning, I also want to thank the Department of Management for having me for this session. So it's about image building, though I titled it as image management. But then, as you build the image, you also have to manage it. It's not enough to build it and leave it. So let me begin with the basic. What do we mean by image? Anybody wants to respond?
Thinking.
Sorry? Would any of you
idea are things or idea, image.
Okay.
Reputation.
Idea or things about what? Okay, let me go ahead. I think there is some connectivity issue also. Basically, when we think of an image, what comes to our mind? What comes readily to our mind is probably a picture or a photograph. So we are not talking about that, though it's partly, probably later we will come back and touch about some of those elements of physical appearance. It is neither even a sought after aura. We only see around celebrities. When we see celebrities, whether sports or entertainment, we all have some kind of, we see some kind of aura or a halo around their head, which probably gives some kind of understanding or image about them. Basically, when I say an image is the picture another person has of us and also what you have of you. I know that's what the first point says. What others see in you or what picture you have about yourself. So when we say this, it could also include number of other things. When I have to think of myself, then it also includes my self-confidence and many other things that I think about. If I think too highly of myself, that is also bad. If I am on low on self-confidence, that also is not going to help me. So the elements of image or appearance could include clothing, grooming, and body language. That also includes our etiquette. Etiquette is the way you conduct yourself. These could be somewhat stimulating cues or clues for others to know what kind of person I am. These are some kind of signs to be assessed or judged mostly on what we probably do not say. It's not based on what we speak all the time. So it's the image is a physical representation of who you are and what you are all about. Let me repeat, it is about who you are and what you are all about. It's not just who you are, but it is also what you are all about. Let me explain this. You know, when we say what you are all about, I've listed some of those things. What you are inside, values, attitudes, interests, abilities, your uniqueness, roles, your dreams, goals, etc. You know, so all this could go on to constitute an image. So when we say who you are and what you are all about, so who you are, we will come back to it. So let me also make another statement. We are not what we do. We are different from what we do. You know, let me repeat this. We are not what we do. We are different from what we do. For example, if you were to think about me, I'm a teacher, I'm a communicator, but that's not who I am at the core. You know, it is only an external expression of what I do. I could be a teacher, I could be a communicator, I could be, you know, speaking some message. But that's not who I am at the inside. These are things just I do, though these have a bearing. And let me come back to that again. So what I am is probably when I say what, how do we define people when we say what? For example, I'm a teacher. So that is what I am. And if you think about my beliefs and religion and so on, I'm a Christian. So that is what I am. And it could be even a Muslim, or even it could be your role as a father, husband, and so on. So these are all what, you know, for when I relate to you, it could be son, daughter, and so on. So these are all what you are. You know, these are not the image. You are not going to carry the image of a son or a daughter or a teacher, you know, when it comes to me all the time. And now, so let's be very careful when we think about what defines an image. So what, that doesn't constitute, that doesn't completely define our image, though it is going to have a bearing. Keep that in mind. And how? The next question is how. When I say how, if I am a teacher, how good or how bad am I a teacher? You know, am I right or wrong if I come to my values? If I'm a practicing Christian, what is right, what is wrong, I should be doing, why should not be doing? You know, so this is about how. So what, for example, in my case is a teacher, and how would again redefine me? Because say if you take the example of our own college, let's say we have about 75 teachers, and all 75 teachers would carry a different image, because how they do things as teacher, one is different from the other. So you cannot just stereotype and say this is the image of, though we have stereotype images, teachers are not supposed to do this, they are supposed to be role models, they are supposed to be this and so on. But then that is the overall general thing. But when it comes to individualistic thing, how I do determines what kind of person I am. I'm sure all of you would agree with me. And this is where people usually have conflicts. What I see good in you, somebody else might say, this is not so good. You know, so that is where the conflict could be. So I might look at you as a bright, a good student, a student with good character and so on. But somebody with slightly different values would think, you know, a little differently when it comes to this. So how also, it's not a final determination of what you are or who you are. But then how plays a major role, though there could be conflicts in these areas, because a lot of emotions also go in there. And then finally, who? When I say who, this is where our values and other things come. When you say who, probably I said what is, I'm a teacher. Suppose how, I'm a good teacher or a communicator. And then who, what kind of identity that gives. It is, am I honest? I am loving. Am I loving? Am I passionate about my, you know, teaching? Am I caring when it comes to showing, you know, empathy or sympathy to students? Or am I just express those things in words, and then I don't do anything beyond that, because caring also involves response in action. And then sincerity, creativity, so many other things could go on. So let's remember, when we think of an image, it is always what, how, and who. You know, all should go together. Let me again give my own example. You know, if I were to talk about my own example, say, for example, I believe in God, and that God says we are all created in His image. When I am created in God's image, what does that give me? That gives me value. That gives me importance, because I am not just an ordinary person. I am of a person of great worth and value, because the God whom I believe in says I am created in His image. And so I consider it as a privilege. You know, so what should I do? Because that God also says He is loving towards human beings. So when God loves me, that adds more value to my life, because somebody who is so great as God, He loves me, that feeling gives me a greater sense of achievements, greater sense of satisfaction. So now what happens? I'm just talking about my own example. So now my aspiration should be to produce that kind of image. Somebody who is of worth, somebody who is of value, somebody, you know, because I trust these things, and that is how it should be. So it again depends on your value system. Let me move on with the next slide. Yeah. This is what he says. William Shakespeare, all of you would know. Some of you would have read some of his plays, or even in a story form. In the play Hamlet, he says, it's in Old English, but I'm sure we'll be able to follow. For the apparel oft proclaims the man. What do we mean by apparel? The dress, you know, the outward appearance of you. Often, oft is often, proclaims the man. That includes even woman, though he says man, it's only a representation. So the way you appear often, you know, proclaims who you are, what you are. So that is about the external part of it. And then in Henry VI, he says, in thy face, I see the map of honor, truth, and loyalty. In other words, you know, your face expresses honor and truth and loyalty, it says. See, this is what the values that we reflect that makes us. Though he has written it a number of years ago, and it's so true in the current context. So everyone produces an image, consciously or unconsciously. Basically, you are, it is all how you project or reflect yourself. So when I say to project an image implies a purposeful, proactive effort. You know, it's not like I get up out of the bed, how I appear, I would appear to people and they will think who I am and what I am and how I am. That is one way. I don't project my image. But when you think of this topic, image building and then management, you are proactively taking some steps. You will do deliberately some purposeful actions, actions that would bring in some effort, some result. It is also a conscious behavior. You know, all of us, that's what we do. For example, if you go for an interview, what do? We all, you know, try to project our best, because there is also a saying, the first impression is the best impression. And also it's in front of strangers, you know, our parents, children, our the siblings and our teachers, our friends may know to a great extent who we are by the simple fact that we are with them. The time where we spend with them is more. So probably they will know us inside out to a great extent. But when we go for an interview situation, all of us try to do our best. We wear our best apparel, best dress, formal dress. And then we also try to impress. But then the people who on the other side are also smarter. They know how to see through all your you know, external facade or makeup that you try to project. So this is what it is. When you say image is, when we think about image building or image management, it is a very conscious effort. In other words, the very purpose of this session is not to, you know, make every one of us understand what is image, but it is also to make us understand where we stand, how we could project a very positive image, reflect an image that truly represents us till it becomes unconscious. You know, people say when you do things consciously a few times, maybe seventh or eighth time, and then you become unconscious projector of that. You know, if I were to give a very simple example, many of you know driving, or all of you know that. And when you are a new driver, what do? You look at the steering wheel, you look at probably where the brakes are, and you know, you struggle, and you know where the gear is. And when you shift gear, probably you would also see, and even when you put the key in to start the vehicle, you probably would bend and see where that key slot is so that it would go. But then after a few days of driving, what happens? You know, after a month or two, when you become from that conscious kind of driver, you become unconscious driver. You don't even bother. You just get in. You know where the slot is. Just you insert the key. You start. You don't care which. You don't consciously try to see whether you are driving in the first gear, second gear, third, fourth, and so on. You know, it just happens very unconsciously. But initially, it is very purposeful. Initially, it is very conscious. You know, otherwise, you would not learn. But that's what happens with our life as well. You know, once you start doing things, it becomes part of us. And then automatically, we project a very good image. So I want us to look at this picture. It's a scanned picture. May not be very clear to you. Deliberately, I have cut out the face. Just for a moment, look at the picture and then tell me your reflections about this man. What is the kind of, you know, understanding about this man? Since the picture is not clear, let me also tell you, on the forearm, he has a tattoo of an eagle. Rest of the things you could see there. So that is not very clear. Just above his wristwatch, you find a tattoo mark. I'll just give you a moment and then I'll hear your responses. Because this exercise is to show everybody stimulates or provokes some response or some impression. When we look at somebody, we get some kind of impression which stays for longer time. So the image is continuously at work. Any responses? What kind of person he is, how, what values he could be having? Can we just guess looking at this? Remember what I said, what, how, and who? Can we define? Any of you, please?
Yeah, anybody knowing can reply.
Looks like a badass person.
Sorry?
Bodybuilder.
Badass. Okay, he could be a bodybuilder. Okay, anything else?
Sir, he looks like a thief.
Looks like police. Thief. Okay. Thief. Okay.
Police.
Police or a thief. It could be both, either of it. Okay. Sorry, holding what?
He's looks like a soldier or a mercenary.
Looks like a soldier. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Other responses, please, quickly.
He's waiting near a railway station or railway gate, something.
Okay, he's near a railway gate or a railway station. Okay. Yeah, more than...
Fearless person, sir.
Fearless.
Yeah.
Okay, fearless. Okay, let's have all, let's remember all these responses as we go along. Yeah. Few more. Fearless, somebody said negative thief, somebody said he could be police, somebody said he's a bodybuilder. Any other image of this person whose face we do not know? Deliberately we hid the face because face is more expressive. Yeah, anything else about him?
He had some tattoo on his hand.
Yeah, that I already said. So how, what values probably he is carrying and what kind of person he is, do you think?
Hardworking person.
Okay, hardworking. No, that is nothing to do with tattoo, right?
The body, sir.
Okay, yeah, that shows. Yeah, fine, hardworking. Somebody said bodybuilder because he is well built, full of muscles. What else? Go ahead. There are a number of clues. You can just look at whatever is visible for you in the picture and make some impressions. It could be right, wrong, fine. Nothing is wrong here.
So we would need to see the tattoo to make an impression of what kind of...
Yeah, I said that it's a tattoo of an eagle. Of an eagle. No, apart from the tattoo, anything else? See, definitely he can't be a teacher. Do any of you think he is a teacher?
No, sir.
Why? A teacher is not expected to come like this with a tattoo and things like that, right? And also what he is holding in his hand. Did you notice that?
Yes.
So, what is your impression?
Actor.
Actor, okay.
Maybe an alcoholic.
Maybe an alcoholic, a drinker, okay.
A partying type of a person, sir.
Okay, party type of person. Party animal, as people say. Okay.
Could be a don.
Could be a don, okay, great. Because he's well built, he seems to be rough and tough with tattoos and... Okay.
Powerful and, you know, kind of an impactful personality.
Powerful and impactful. Impactful in what sense? Negative, positive?
Could be both ways, sir.
Could be both ways. Okay. Why do you think both ways? What is positive? What one positive thing you find about him?
I look into the negative only because maybe like the kind of answers we're getting, he looks like a don.
No, you don't base your opinion on others. When you look at the picture, what do you think of this person?
He's very powerful person, sir. Like, you know, he tries to influence someone or could be like that.
Yeah, it's somebody like a don, as somebody said. Yeah.
For his own deeds or something like that.
Okay. Great. What do you see in his shirt pocket? What do you think is bulging?
Lighter.
Why do you think it's a lighter?
Lighter. Somewhat like in a rectangular shape, not even 6 to 7 centimeters of length. And
okay.
3 to...
Is it Surya?
Aditya.
Aditya, okay. Okay. See, now we can go on and on. Now, even without looking at the face of the person, and remember, this is only a scanned image, not a person live in front of your eyes. But then we made so much of interpretation, you know, mostly negative, truly so. Probably, yes, this is a don because, you know, the rough and tough he looks. He has a, you know, some liquor bottle in his hand. The way he holds it shows that he's not a novice. He's used to drinking. So somebody said he could be a regular drinker. Because he's a regular drinker, when you look at his pocket, it appears like a lighter, right, or a matchbox, whatever. Because we assume if he drinks, he should also smoke. If I were to replace these images, the bottle in his hand with something else, then you would not probably think it's a lighter. You would probably think it's something else. You know, maybe some visiting card or some pouch or whatever. So probably you would not think of it. And if I were to put a duster in his hand and is a little slim, not well-built, probably you will think he's a teacher and, you know, having a chalk piece in his pocket or things like that. So now, what is the purpose of this little exercise? It is to show that everybody all the time stimulates or provokes some impression in the mind of the onlooker. So when I go out, people look at me and they go on forming images. So that image could be, some of them could be right, some of them could be wrong. You know, so we, over which we have no control at that point of time. So what do we need to do? So in other words, people are continuously or continually at work forming images about you. And you cannot just hide it. Sometime it will work for you. Sometimes it could work against you, because sometime when you are at the interview, certain things you said, the way you said it, how you said it, probably you never meant it, but that's how it appeared to the other person. So you are not selected. You know, they think you are not so honest. They think probably you are not so fit for the job that they are interviewing people for. So it could go against or for. So what we need to do, in other words, if it is so, then we have to basically keeping our goals in mind, keeping our values in mind, constantly try to produce the image that you want to project. And once you start doing this, you also need to sustain it. So that is what building is all about. You know, it's not just one day you appear like this, other days it is fine, but then you have to sustain it. You know, some of the points that you find on this slide, I've already said, to reflect an image implies passive, unconscious. You don't do anything, but to project an image is purposeful, proactive, and it is conscious. So in the second point only, we are talking about image management or image building. The first one, you are not just bothered. You just appear whatever way you want to. You are very passive. You are not taking any action. It's okay, whatever people think of me, and I have nothing to lose. You know, you just let yourself go. But most of the time, our life cannot be like that. And we want to project a good image in front of a teacher, in front of our even parents. You know, in deep inside, we know who we are. But when we come back home, what do? We try to project a very good image in front of our parents and our brothers and sisters, and so on. So to project or to build or to manage an image is a very conscious thing. And other things I have already said, you are assessed, evaluated, judged based on the image. Your image influences public perception of you, and it results in impression of you, and it has a great bearing in your life. I'm sure all of you agree on that, because whatever people think, accordingly, you will get opportunities or you will miss opportunities. Okay, before we go on to talk about image management, any questions at this stage? We have all understood what is an image and how we need to project a positive image, which means we have to take some proactive steps. We have to consciously probably train ourselves to do something, at least in the beginning, the way we drive a car, till it becomes part of us, till it becomes an unconscious reflection, and then continue building on it, sustain it. We cannot just let that go. So we'll have to do that. Okay, before I go further, any questions or anything you would like to add? If I don't hear anything, that mean I go ahead? Okay. I've just titled it as ABCD of image management, easy to remember. A standing for appearance. You know, that includes clothing, grooming, body language, etiquette, and so on. I'm sure the kind of clothes you wear will also convey an image. For example, as a teacher, can I come into one of your classes with spangled trousers, multicolored trousers, and shiny, when I say spangled, mirror objects, usually the ladies' dresses would have. Can I come in like that into a classroom? I cannot. But then if I am an entertainer, say, for example, a pop singer, an actor, probably I would not mind wearing that kind of clothing because that image is different. But if I am a teacher, I am expected to reflect that, you know, so clothing also should reflect. That is why many of the institution, including ours, have dress code for teachers. What kind of dress we should wear, what we should not wear. It's not always left to our personal choice. You know, so that is to, as an institution, to project an image. This is how our teachers are. This is how our students are, and so on. And grooming is a very personal thing. Grooming is nothing but the way you were brought up and your habits and, you know, whatever you, how the way you do things, all those things reflect on grooming. Body language, it's a very wide subject. Probably, you know, it requires a number of hours to study. But generally, body language is the way you sit, the way you stand, the way you walk, the way facial expressions, eye contact, and things like that. These are all added in body language. So even when we sometimes, when we say something which is not true, people can still find out from your body language what you are speaking is a lie. Have you ever seen little children when they come running into their home and parents will ask, say, suppose 3-year-old or 4-year-old children, and then the child tries to tell a lie, what does the child do? It will not make eye contact. It will try running here and there and it will try to bend down. These are all unconscious things. So parent will know, okay, child is lying. And when you grow up, and suppose you come late and your parents have said by this particular time you should be home, you are late, and your dad will be so angry and you can't face him. What do? Probably you try sneaking in through a side door, or, you know, you try avoiding meeting that kind of person at that point of time. So body language is a big giveaway. You know, some years ago, I don't think I have it now, but I can look for it. There was an article written by a couple of people who were at the airport. Their flight was delayed, so they didn't know what to do. So they together, they wrote an article. They wrote some outline and wrote an article. It is called How to Read a Person Like a Book. So they were looking at people at the airport lobby at the lounge, and somebody is on the phone. So they are trying to guess to whom the person is talking. By the way, he's standing, whether he is talking to a girlfriend or talking to a manager, talking to his wife. So it's a beautiful, you know, write-up. So all of us know when you see somebody on the phone in one corner, trying to hold the phone as an object of affection, trying to turn away towards the wall from people, you know to whom that person is talking. You know, he doesn't want anybody to see him or see her or hear. And if suppose a boss calls somebody on the phone, wherever you observe the body language, immediately it will be standing to attention. You know, it happens unconsciously. So body language is a big indicator of what kind of, so we can be trained in that. As I said, positive, you know, proactive steps can remove some of the negative expressions in our body language. And then etiquette, I'm sure all of us know, is correct behavior. In a classroom, how should you behave? When you go to a restaurant, how do you behave? When you go to a public place, how do you behave? At home, how do you behave? All these are etiquettes. And then our behavior as well, that B standing for behavior, that also, again, to a great extent, related to our attitude that we carry. So I may show myself to be a very kind person or very responsible, responsive, and so on. You know, so communication plays a vital role. The way you communicate, it's not only the words speaking, but through body language you can communicate. But also the way that you speak could determine how polished you are. The words that we use in a particular language will show whether you are educated, not so educated, from which area you come from, depending on dialect. And, you know, but because certain geographical areas have certain ways of speaking, which we call it dialect. So communication could also add to the image. So we all have mother tongue influence when we speak English. So how much of it we could remove in order to show when the world has become global. So we are expected to almost near perfect. So all this could build up our image. So if you speak well, you know, have you ever seen that happening? You are in trouble and, you know, when you come across a policeman, he stops your car and asks you some questions. You speak in English, most of the time he lets you go. Have you ever noticed that? You know, it happens unconsciously because certain things, say in our nation and certain places, if you speak in a particular language, you are supposed to be polished. You are not supposed to behave in a bad manner. And I'm just using a very common example. And, you know, the last one in the current scenario is, in the current age, is very important. You know, when you say digital footprint, it's nothing but, it's a kind of dossier, a file that you consciously or unconsciously leave behind. It could be active data, it could be passive data. I'm sure all of us are familiar, all of us are out on the social media platforms, and the kinds of things that we write there, the kinds of things that we respond, your likes and dislikes or whatever smileys, emoticons you put there for a particular message, or the way you write things there, the pictures you post, these are all called digital footprint. Because even if you want to wish away, it cannot be removed totally. So there could be many things actively. I may be posting some pictures and maybe writing something, but sometimes passively also I leave something unintentionally on Facebook, Twitter, or, you know, blog post or various other social network platforms. We do that. It could be image, video uploads, the things that I put like, it could be even chats, and these all create very active footprints. Passive data traces to individuals, you know, some to an individual that are left by others, gathered through activities that the user does without you don't put something purposefully, but say, suppose, for example, you visit a couple of websites. You know, you think you can hide it or you go in incognito window, but somewhere it is all there. If somebody wants to, you know, when police catches a criminal these days, the first thing they also do is to, if he's, you know, from an office or somewhere, they take away the hard disk, they take away the computer to analyze. Why? Because though you think you have deleted some of those things, it will be a big giveaway. So all the searches you make, I'm sure all of you as young people would know this. When you open your Gmail, there could be number of ads that are coming up, popping up on the right and left and wherever. And have you ever noticed it is based on your searches? Suppose I search for flight ticket this morning from Hyderabad to Delhi. When I open my Gmail, 2-3 ads would come saying that this site is offering flight ticket to Delhi. Why don't you book? Couple of days, it would keep coming. Next time I go to some other website, I search for something else, say a property in Bangalore, ads would pop up on my screen. And whatever I do is somewhere there. So even online purchases, the purchases you make, it will pop up again, you know, whether you open a Gmail or Google Chrome or whatever, it just pops up. Many times we wonder, how do they know? But then if you are aware of the footprints that you are leaving behind, you would be careful, because many times, many advanced countries, when they grant visa, they go into your social media accounts and they see for certain types of visa. for admissions, for job, and you know what kind of person they have to just get access to your social media thing. It's not a very difficult thing. So digital footprint is relatively permanent. You cannot do anything. Once the data is in public, it may be hidden from your eye and somebody's eye, but it is never going to go away. So be careful about Facebook posts, you know, and you don't have much control over it. So a major focus should be on digital footprint management. They say DFM. You know, so you will have to be very careful thinking 5 years from now, if I'm going to be a manager, will I be ashamed of the post that I am posting today? You know, if it is so, let's not do it. Is it in conflict with the values that I hold? You know, so let us not post or let us not like such things. So that is what we'll have to be careful about when it comes to digital footprint. Okay, as we move along, image management, when you think of image management, it's an ongoing thing. It's not that, okay, 10 days I have attended this session, so I've learned it. Now I've, you know, started practicing some of these things. It's not going to help you. So it is basically creating an authentic, appropriate, as I have said there, attractive, and a kind of personal and professional image. This will also increase your confidence, your credibility, your capability, and it will lead you to success. You know, it's when you say attract others, all of us need to do this in order to capture somebody. As students, you may want to prove yourself to be a good student. You try to attract the attention of the teachers or your fellow classmates or the principal. Tomorrow at the workplace, we all want to impress our bosses through their tasks that we accomplish. So there is nothing wrong in that. So positive self-presentation is an open invitation for people to come become friendly with you as well. So image management is very important. It's an ongoing thing, and nothing wrong in doing this. You can do it at home, college, community. So your parents will see you as a better son, better daughter, and, you know, better brother and sister and so on. Some people have a natural talent or ability to present themselves, but all of us may not be gifted all the time. So, but then we don't have to worry. The good news is that it can be learned. It can be learned. And so if it can be learned, certainly you can also take steps. It could be through an online program. It could be through our own, you know, sessions like this could open up opportunities for you. You may not learn much in a 1 hour session, but you know what is there. Do you know, before I close, I want to say this, image consulting is a big career today. You know, it's a big service industry, a field of work where image consultants help clients. You know, mostly celebrities hire them. What do? They help them improve their appearance for personal or professional reasons. That is what even Prime Minister did when he was a Chief Minister of Gujarat. And then from that time till now, if you see him, the confidence that he has grown, you know, the with which he speaks all the time, his body language is so powerful. You know, I often, not very often these days because of the lockdown, he's been addressing the nation. So you would see him. And have you seen his attire? Consciously, you know, people say how far it is true, we don't know. But certainly he had image consultant to improve his image in the initial days and to continue with the kinds of clothes he wears, very crisp, very, you know, and also the coat he wears. Originally, it was a Nehru coat, as people would say. Now it has become a Modi coat, and it is sold everywhere from high-end to low-end markets. You will find that it's become so popular. It's all because of that image building. Somebody was behind him trying to tell him, and the way he speaks, have you seen? He just opens his arms wide and, you know, that shows that he is so confident when he speaks something. So certainly he has learned. I'm using a practical example again. If he has learned, and many of the actors, actresses, and celebrities, they learn. They hire a consultant Though it is very expensive, in case of Prime Minister, they said he hired some American consultants for huge amount. I have no clue whether it's true or not, but certainly he must have had some consultant to help him to build his image in order to project a positive image in front of the masses and then leading to his success. So this is what all of us need not hire people, because celebrities can afford to do them. They advise them. They even go to the shops to buy clothes for them and how it should be tailored and who should design. And when they are in the public platform, how should they stand? How should they sit? How should they even giggle or smile? Or all these things are taught. You know, over a period of time, they learn all this and that costs huge money. So there is a lot of scope. If any of you are thinking of becoming an image consultant, all that, there is an institute here in India and there are number of private institutes which offer courses on image management and image consulting to pick up some of those finer areas. You know, they will advise if you are tall and lean, what kinds of clothes you should wear, what colors, what patterns, and if you are short and otherwise, how, what kind of thing, depending on your skin tone, color, they would advise you. It's nothing but, you know, to project the kind of particular image the people want to project. Politicians are good in doing it. Celebrities are good in doing it, whether sports or actors and actresses. And they deliberately, you know, project a particular image so it remains with you. So here I also want to say one thing. There is a kind of difference between personal branding and image management. When we think of personal branding, it is what people expect from you. But when it's more about creating that kind of perception in the minds of people. But image management is more about building and managing that kind of brand which you have created so that people will continue to look at you in a particular way. Say, for example, I might have a brand image of being politically aware. Now, people think, okay, this fellow knows everything about politics. He is politically very much aware. But now, when it comes to management, tomorrow, somebody on a public platform or in a class like this asks some questions about politics. And if I don't answer them properly, appropriately, depending on what kind of questions were asked, I would be, you know, spoiling my image. My brand of being politically aware, the initial image of being politically aware has gone for a toss, because after I speak for 2 minutes, people discover, oh, it's all, you know, it's not true. He doesn't know much. And then the image they are going to, which they, which the, from that moment, that image will change. The next time they look at you, they are going to look at you in a slightly different manner. Oh, he is only a pretender. He doesn't know much. You know, from person who is being aware, now the image has moved to being a pretender, because a few questions about being politically aware, I could not manage well. So it also, it's about not only our appearance, our behavior, our attitude, it's also about our knowledge. You know, because knowledge adds power to yourself. The more you know about things, today people are talking about COVID-19, talking about quarantine, talking about technology. Today, you and I would not be using this technology but for this lockdown period, right? I have learned in this last 2 months or so, so much of technology, which otherwise I would not have learned. I have tried attending a few webinars, how to be very effective on, you know, video conferencing like this. And so all these go on to show, whether I do it or don't do it, it may not matter at this stage of my life. But then why I continue to do certain things? Because I want to probably, you know, sustain that image people have of me so that I would not let myself down. That is what image building and management is all about. Certainly, it's a positive thing as young people, especially as you grow and graduate and go out, you need to be, be conscious about this all the time, wherever you go. It's not only at the time of interview, not only inside, but as I said, even what you post in Facebook, what kind of responses you have, certain things maybe we need to withhold, certain things we need to positively project in order to build a good image of ourselves. So I would wish every one of you a great career, a great future. And with all of your effort, with God's help, you need to do your best. I'm sure that is why you are part of program like this. So I will end here. And if you have any questions, I would take if there is time. Thank you so much for your patient listening. Now it's my turn to listen.
Any questions, anybody?
Is it okay to create a first impression by seeing a person? See, if we create an impression on that person by a first look, afterwards we come to know that person is something different from what we think of him.
Mm-hmm.
So the impression that we have in our mind cannot change suddenly.
That's absolutely true. That is why they say the first impression is the best impression.
Yes. Right?
So yes. We have to be very careful whether in times of interview or anything that would make your life decision. You should be very careful about projecting a very positive image. You don't have to pretend. You don't have to act too much. But usually it happens. All of us do when we go for an interview, we try our best to impress. But in the process, sometimes we fail, right?
Yes.
Because too much of pressure on us to impress, it happens. And similarly, when a boy and a girl, when they reach the marriageable years and they try to impress, you all know how it happens. You try to impress each other initially, but then after 10 days, 15 days, everything is bare open. You know, this is not the person I thought of. Yes. And then you start, adjusting yourself to the person if you continue your life. So that is why it is so important. We don't know when people would look at us and form impressions. It's not always you are given an opportunity. So I will present myself in my best form and my best attitude and so on. But then you may be caught unaware. Somebody looks at you, somebody, forms impressions about you. We don't know when. So that is why we should consciously all the time be careful of what we do, how we do, and what we are.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, welcome. In other words, we cannot just separate it from our life and say, okay, when I go to work, when I go to college, let me build this image. Now I'm free, I can do what I want. You're not supposed to do it, right?
Yes, there are so many people who do that thing. So I have that doubt. See, when we go outside to do a party, we behave in a different way.
Yes.
But when we are in a professional or like that parties, we will be different in that way. So I have a doubt.
Yeah, but then what kind of image, what you want people to think about you? That is what will determine what image you will project.
Yes.
If it's okay for you to go for parties, it's up to you. I may not do it. But then each individual takes a decision. What kind of image you want to... I'm not being judgmental here about what we... That's why I said when you say how, good, bad, right, wrong, could put us in conflict. Because yes. What is good for me may not be good for... you may not be good for me. Because it depends on the value system that is inside, right? And the way you were brought up by your parents and all those things. And finally, what you want to become and where you want to be, all this would determine your image. So it depends.
Yes, sir.
All right. Sir,
yeah.
I have a question. When we go by this, don't think about what others feel about you and you just go the way you were.
And how do you address image management in this, sir?
See, human beings are not standalone creatures, right? I'm sure you would agree with me. And there are times that we are forced to do certain things in order to please our bosses, our colleagues, our students, or even our family members. So if I say I don't care about what others think, I will do what I want. What kind of image are you creating? You know, initially, if somebody is like that, what word comes to your mind first? If somebody, see, often we find in our families, in our society, somebody who cares a hang for anything, doesn't care at all. I let them think what they want. I will do the way I want to do things and the things that I want to do. We classify such person as a rebel, right?
Yes.
We classify such person as a rebel. That's what happens. So we are expected to adhere to certain norms of the society, of the religion, of our family values, and of our institution. Because if you belong to St. Mary's, we want you to carry a certain image. We don't want that. That is what will differentiate you from other graduates. If you're thinking of a institutional image, you know, the way we do things, each department is doing different things. You have a finishing school. For example, in BA, some of you would be aware, we have an ongoing e-conclave by alumni and students every day. And it's, you know, based on this current situation, they talk about their experience. So why do we do all that? It is to make you different from as students. All are equal when it comes to Usmania University examination, marks memo, and things like this. But then we want our students to be different. Even within our own institution, each department wants its students to be different. Because maybe BBA business oriented. In BA, we may not be so business oriented, commerce oriented. So we focus on things that would help them. Tomorrow, when you go out, when my student goes out, you know, they carry a different kind of image. They'll say, oh, St. Mary's, this is how it should be, general. You know, after that, it's up to you to continue and sustain it.
Yeah.
Get my point? Many times we do things, you know, for the sake of others. And we are, as long as we are in the society, we are expected to, that's what I said. As a teacher, I'm not expected to do certain things. You find me partying somewhere tomorrow, right, wrong, that is a totally different thing. Good, bad, it's totally a different area. But then, however good at is, when I come into your classroom, you know how students will look at me, right? Is that true? Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, some years ago, I remember, I would not tell his name. He would often say this. He is part of us, in a very valued colleague in St. Mary's. He was narrating in one of the staff seminars where we were talking about values of a teacher. So while he was going on his bike. This was many, many years ago. He was going on his bike and there was a lady behind him. And one of our students, he caught up with him, applied brake and asked him whether he's carrying his wife behind or somebody else. You know, so he just, because the teacher is very friendly, he didn't, you know, the student couldn't keep it to himself. He thought somebody on teacher's bike behind should be a wife. So this colleague would always tell me, though it was his wife behind, even if I was not carrying my wife, still I would have said, it's my wife. Why? Because if I carry somebody else, the student, you know, the value and the morality that they attach to teacher could be affected. You get my point here? But if you are an engineer, doctor, you go with somebody else, no patient will come and ask you whether, sir, is it your wife? You know, but because as teachers, you are expected to set high moral standards. So the student was so curious, he had to, you know, it was a real life incident, maybe 15 years ago or 16 years ago, happened to a colleague of ours. So that's a good example, because teachers are expected to do certain things and not to do certain things, not to be found in certain places, however they like or dislike. you know, this is all about image. So as a teacher, even if I want to do certain things, I should not be doing it. Because if I do, it's so difficult for me to come and stand in the class and talk to you again. So that goes with every profession, every part of life. So image building is, many times we do it for others' sake as well.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Any other questions, Mohit and all? No questions?
Sir?
Yes.
As you said that, like being a teacher, you have to behave in a certain way. But however, it is a personal life and a professional life, no, sir. So both are different.
Yeah.
So how does it even matters?
That I should see. See, suppose you find me partying, drinking, smoking somewhere along with, in, let's say, in some pub, I come back to my class tomorrow morning. Do you think I would be welcomed the way that other teachers are welcomed? There will be sniggers, there will be some, you know, comments. The respect that you generally have for me would have gone down. Don't you think so? I just use a practical example. It could be anything. It could be anything. It's not just drinking and smoking and doing other things. But it could be anything. We are expected to, you know, that's why I said society has put some norms. Whether I like it or not, it takes to the previous question, which said, you know, should we do it for the sake of others? Sometimes, yes, we are to do it. And then you know me as a person, a teetotaler, and, you know, so you valued all that. And suddenly you find me this. And, you know, why do you think that boy went and overtook this teacher and asked whether really the lady behind pillion riding is his wife? Because he was holding certain values to this teacher. He didn't want his teacher to be seen with some other lady, honestly. So he could not. It was not a fun thing. It just went, we wanted to make sure he was carrying his wife. What is his problem if he was carrying somebody else? Absolutely, this should not be a problem. But then, you know, that's the kind of world we live in. So we have to, right? We all project certain images. So you cannot just say, how does it matter? It also depends on the profession. Suppose you are an entertainer. Probably easily, if you are found in a pub, there it won't make news. But if I am found there, I'm sure I will make news as well. They will write, some newspaper reporter will write, a teacher is found drinking every day here and things like that. But somebody else drinks, there may not be a problem.
Yes.
So this is just a common example. It's not just about drinking. And why can't I dress the way I want to dress and come into your classroom? Maybe in shorts, Bermudas, and, you know, or a t-shirt. Why do you think as teachers?
Because the set of norms that college you have to follow.
Yeah, because no, it's not only norms. Why did the institution set norms? You tell me. Why? Were they unreasonable in saying you should not do these things as a teacher? It's not. It is not at all that. It is because to project a positive image about their teachers. And every teacher individually has to take effort. Similarly, as collectively as an institution, they also want to project an image. So these are set norms and it cannot be changed. And if you break those norms, then you are found to be a rebel. And if these norms have become rules in institutions and organizations, then you are expected to adhere to them. Clearly, otherwise your appraisal time, you will have problem. You cannot, you know, get a good appraisal.
Sir, so, but how do you address this kind of a work culture of having a casual wear, like, organizations like Google and everywhere, yes, they go in a very casual outfit even to the top level professional meetings.
Because Google follows a very flat structure, and they are, see, it depends again on the institution and the kind of profession that you choose, right? So yeah. It's also the institutional culture that would again build up your own image. So by staying in St. Mary's, I would have become part of St. Mary's, their culture, their norms for so many years. But for somebody who is coming in as a new teacher, it might take a year or two. It might even, that's where we sometimes have conflicts. You know, certain new joinees are sometimes told individually by the HR, please avoid wearing this kind of dress, this kind of things. And, you know, such things do happen even in our institution. Why? Not because it's good, bad, right, wrong. It's because as a teacher, as an institution, we want our teachers to be like this. And everybody is. Even it applies to students as well. You know, yeah. Certain dress you are not allowed in with shorts and things like that. Maybe in an American campus, all those things possible. But to keeping our culture, keeping our, you know, norms, certain rules are framed. So we are expected to follow that. So that, so we cannot stand aside and build my own image.
Yeah.
No, being part of one organization, you have to, the first thing they tell you in an organization is your goals, your, you know, everything should be aligned with the institution. There should not be any conflict. When they say aligned, you will have to fall in line, in other words. Otherwise, you may quit and go, or otherwise they might throw you out if it's a serious violation. So what do you do? You have joined a particular company and certain things you don't like, maybe way of dressing, certain restrictions they tell you even about hairstyle and things like that. But then what choice do you have? If you want to build your career in that organization, you have to fall in line, build your image in alignment with the image of the college, and then grow. Otherwise, you will have to quit and find a place where, you know, you would be at peace. So the choice is yours. Nobody will force you to do anything. But individually, as individuals also, we want in our neighborhood, in our street, we want everybody to know us to be good or honest or whatever the labels they want to give. So we do it accordingly, right? So this is what is all about. So we cannot just separate personal life. See, I always say this even in teacher development programs and things. One cannot be a good teacher unless you are a good son, good daughter, good husband, good wife, good mother, good father. You cannot say it is my personal life. As a husband, I would be like this to my wife. As a father, I would be like this to my daughters and come back and be a good teacher. It's just impossible. You cannot compartmentalize your life. You know, it goes. That's when sometimes you have problem at home, it will reflect when people come to workplaces. You know, they cannot work peacefully. They cannot be at their best. So I believe in it. I try practicing it. So I tell you, you cannot compartmentalize. If you are a good student, you should also be a good employee. If you are a good employee, you should also be a good son or a daughter to your parents. You know, you cannot just be good in one area and leave out the other areas. So it's a basically overall holistic, overall development of yourself. So when you look at it that way, everywhere you will try to improve. So if you become a good son to your parents, good daughter to your parents, that will reflect in the classroom. You will also be a good student to your teachers, and you will be a good friend to your classmates. And tomorrow that could be carried on to the. So let's not, you know, think it's personal and professional. Everything is, it's all the same. Life is one. So we are not supposed to compartmentalize, and you cannot excel when you compartmentalize. Take it from me. You cannot excel when you compartmentalize. You know, when I go to church, I am good. So Monday to Saturday, I will do what I want. Again, I go back. It's not going to work. So what values I believe in, whether it's a church, classroom, or, you know, wherever I'm expected to carry those values, carry those things. Then only I would be successful. I would be building one. Otherwise, there will be conflicting images. They will see me on Sunday like this. They will see me Monday differently, Friday differently. So people will know, oh, he's a fake. He's neither here nor there, you know. So
yes, sir. Got it.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for these questions. These are good ones.
Yes. And we are running out of time also. So, Gayatri? Okay.
Yeah, ma'am. That was an incredible session by Joseph, sir. It sure helped us all to rewire our inner thoughts on image management. We learned a lot on image. That is a representation of who you are and also what you are, all about our values, attitude, uniqueness, and abilities, which constitutes an image. We learned a lot from conscious to unconscious behavior on projecting an image, to the ABCD of image management, and many more. Thank you, Joseph, sir, for an interesting session. Thank you, sir.
Welcome. It's my pleasure talking to all of you. And I'm sure you've learned something. You'll try practicing some of those things. Only then the session would be fruitful. Yes, thank you. I'm sure you will.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Sure.